growing a business is something that can have very many different interpretations for people, and perhaps, you know, there's an interpretation that is, something we might expect to be about getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So I wanted to have to ask both Kathy and Melanie to give me their interpretations of what does it mean to grow your own way. So Melanie, do you want to kick off the conversation?
Hi everyone, thanks for having me. So I have a Canadian accent, even though I live in London right now. Feels oddly like a homecoming. It's my first time to Australia, so thank you for having me. It's my cute little word. In terms of growing a business and why women would start a business, or why anyone would start a business, and how do we value its success, I think it's really important that the economic contribution of women is valued and properly valued as well. Right now, we do have gendered values. So you'll find that the jobs and the input that women have in our communities in regards to childcare, in regards to taking care of our home, taking care of others, the caring services in general, they're not as valued. And when I say value, I'm just talking about the Australian dollar kind of value. And so with business and with starting our own businesses, there is an important negotiation that I think a woman has to go through in herself to say, well, what do I value? And what is my value that I'm bringing out to the world? And what am I getting back from it? What's important to me? And that's an important walk of confidence. I think that every woman who has a small business, who's starting a small business, has to make those decisions. And it's not necessarily about just money. It's also about what you value. Is it time? Is it time for you to leave work at 3 so that you can pick up your children and you can get back to it at 7 o'clock? Is it healthcare and a pension? So it's all of these things that on a woman's journey, what do I value and how do I value it? How do I contribute to society with that value and how am I getting back? And it's an important dependence walk, actually. So it's quite philosophical for me in terms of business.
Okay. I think Kathy and I were talking a bit earlier about, that concept of does size matter? And I think with Kathy, we were talking about, it might not matter really. And what you're saying there, it depends on what you value as a person, and as a woman, as a mother or a daughter or a friend or whoever, or a partner. So Kathy, what's your contribution to that?
Just first of all to say, I'm not a visitor. I am from Brisbane.
I'm here because of her.
Even though I've still got this pommy accent that I can't get rid of, I've been here for 20 years, and I've run my business here for 20 years with somebody who is now my former husband, but was my husband at the time when we first came here. And we came here to actually set up a business, and we'd run it in the UK before then, and we came here to establish it 20 years ago this year. As a result of people saying to us, "There's room in Australia to do what you're doing." The growth issue for me, for going straight to the point of growth, I mean, came out of a conversation that we were having about this as to how you do grow, and I think there is a traditional. I really truly feel that women in business today and the growth of women in business today is happening at a time of incredible structural change. There's a massive paradigm shift going on around everything to do with work and everything to do with legal structures as to how you form your business to earn your income or how you're paid for your labor in the future. And I think this is a really interesting convergence of thinking about that at the same time of women running their own business and actually potentially bringing to business and to those structures around business a different way of thinking about it. And in my own experience, we have not, as a business, grown in size for 20 years. In terms of how one traditionally would think about the scale of that business, i.e. the level of turnover, the number of employees, the thing that has changed is actually the amount of assets. Sorry, I will say we have grown in that sense because of what we've done with the profitability from the business that we've run. But we have not grown in a traditional sense. And we went through that in the UK 20 years ago. We did grow. We grew to employing about 20 people at one time. And I and I've had experience with other colleagues in small business suddenly realized that we could carry on going down that track, and I didn't want to do that. That's not what I was about. That's not what I was about. I wasn't interested in it was partly to do with the nature of the business that I was in, but I was not interested in growing and growing and growing and bringing in more and more contracts and work, et cetera, et cetera, for an ever-expanding structure of that way. I was more interested in actually working in a much smaller way. And when we did grow, or when the opportunity arose so that we could scale what we were doing, we did it by forming partnerships with people. So we work in partnership to do major contracts with other people that have the specific skills that we can bring in to do those. Now, we've been doing that for quite a long time. I mean, I think that's probably something that's beginning to happen more and more now. But that's the way we've been working for the last 20 years. So we can scale up and we can come down regardless. Now, that's nothing to do with the actual business, financial business model in relation to the way in which we do that. But I just think it's a really interesting, when we started talking about this, the notion of growth. There are many ways in which you can grow in scale or whatever, and without thinking about what's necessarily turning your business into a corporate model of the traditional model. And I think that's a really interesting one for women in business to think about, because that allows some of the value propositions that Melanie's talking about to perhaps enter into the way you structure what it is that you do.
And do you think you're talking about how where it's such a time of great change, and there's a very fluid environment around where we're in, and I think there's great opportunity to actually reshape the structure of how you run a business, what you do with your business. And I think, Melanie, your awards, small business awards that you have in the UK, that is all about, isn't it, having that, a bit of a changing the conversation around women and money, you know, all those sort of value judgments around what women can do with their business. Do you want to talk to us a bit more about how that hooks into what Cathy was talking about, how it's a time of great change, so we can be the change?
The awards were, for me, I was just looking up, you know, when I wanted to start my own business. Actually, I don't even think I wanted to start my own business. I never said that to myself, right? I just said, I'm not sure I'm trying to be here anymore. And that was that, you know, I was working for Ernst & Young at the time as a consultant. And the only thing I knew when I was a kid, when I was 4 years old, I had a Winnie the Pooh table. And I used to set it up in front of the house and sell my mother's things. And it was always just about, I was always, not necessarily selling, but that transacting and finding, you know, helping another person find value in what I was selling, and kind of that trade, I loved it. And then later on, you know, when you kind of realize where you are in the world and how people are starting to treat you, then it was about me never being poor and me knowing about my money and loving kind of numbers. So I never really said to myself I wanted to start my own business. I just wanted to do my own thing as well. I just realized that I also loved kind of project work, and I didn't really want to have kind of that day-to-day grind. And so I thought consulting would help me with that in terms of working with different clients. And that's when all of a sudden, you know, at 20 years later, we're like, I started in the branch and I didn't know I was going to stay here for 20 years. And that also gave me the courage to go off and start my own business. And I think that path has to be acknowledged. That you know, you're the learning, the kind of apprenticeship, and it may not be an apprenticeship of the things that you like, but it gives a woman confidence. It's not necessarily that you kind of coming out of any kind of, you know, schooling or when you're 18 and starting a business. Like, you won't necessarily think you're an entrepreneur at 18. Sometimes you need to, let's get into the workplace, and you know, you're starting to grow and you're realizing that the coat doesn't fit any longer, and so you have to just buy a new coat. And that for me was starting my own business. Then I looked up and I was like, ooh, there's not really a lot of people I can look around and talk to about this. Interesting. And so I had to search for them. And when I found them, I was like, yeah, people need to see these people. And they need to share their journeys and their independent journeys as well. They're so different. And most of them were social enterprise-like, and some of them were technology. Some of them were, you know, just massively simple. You know, Kat Kidston, so she's a famous designer. Mm-hmm. And she literally started just designing flowery things at her kitchen table. And she's severely dyslexic to the point where she, you know, asked me to read the menu for her because we were sitting beside each other. And now Kathkiston is an international brand, and it's literally because dyslexia, you know, the way the teachers were treating her, they just didn't, there wasn't room for her in terms of the typical ideas of success. So that being said, all to say that I do think that with, on the road to empowerment for any underrepresented community, whether I am representing Black people, being a Black woman, being a woman, you know, it's, there is something in the, there's a common route no matter where you are in the world, that where you go through to economic, you start to talk about economic empowerment, and wait, you say, wait a minute, I bring value here, and you should be paying me for the, all this value that I'm bringing, and you'll see it no matter where you are, any continent. Mm-hmm. And I think that small business is, that is a way forward for women to really start to really kind of participate in the value that we inherently bring as part of a society. Mm. I'm done now on my little soliloquies. Shorter questions next time. Sorry about that.
It's interesting because Melanie, you were talking before about one of the, obviously one of the winners this year at the British Black Business Awards was a social enterprise, and that's an area that, I mean, I think very much in terms of structures and thinking about, in some senses, how we've run our business over the last 20 years has been much more like a social enterprise, which has been so that what we've created out of the business a couple of nonprofits, mm-hmm. one nonprofit that's to do with governance in nonprofits.
Wait, does everyone know what that is? Social enterprise?
Yes, I think everybody will know what a social enterprise is. And so one non-profit and governance, and then another non-profit, which is of one mind, which is the company that is actually responsible for doing the Women of the World festivals in partnership with. So what we've done is, even though the legal structure for our business has been a private company, ordinary PTL, YLTD company structure, we've actually run it by ploughing the majority of the money we've ever made into it back into particular areas that we are passionate about, and grown things in that way. And back to that growth thing, even though you don't grow in scale, if your brand is growing, if the brand of what you do and the value that you're delivering because of the brand that you're working under is continuing to deliver that value to your customers, you grow anyway. Mm. Without that, and how you then invest that, the money from that, has to be a decision that you take. And there are many, many different structures to do it, which is obviously what's interesting about the new social enterprise structure, and certainly from my point of view, cultural enterprise, because I'm more in the business of cultural enterprise than I am social enterprise. Mm. And that's how I see a lot of arts organizations that are structured as non-profits. But you bet, and many of you from creative industries or creative businesses here, you are delivering a whole range of different values, cultural, social, and economic value. And you have to make a profit now to actually do that. Mm-hmm. How that profit's distributed is entirely up to you. So I think we get a little bit hidebound with all of them. But as women in business, I think we have the capacity to think differently around how we think about structures. I might be making this up, but I'm convinced that we do.
So what's stopping that? I think in some of the research that was done when they were putting together the Advancing Women in Business initiative, was I went out and spoke to, consulted with women, and one of the things that came up was confidence. Mm-hmm. And look, you know, like there was like a real key theme that confidence in women was something that they really needed to work on, and was something that they felt there was a lack of confidence. And I guess the assumption is that, well, it seemed to be that, you know, you wouldn't even ask that question of a male in business, do you know what I mean? Like, they're just naturally confident. So I guess my question is, you know, why does that come up amongst women, and is that a real consideration around the things that you're talking about, Kathy, and also Melanie, around, you know, being the game changers and going in there and creating your own business? And
it's so tough, you know. We do have to acknowledge, again, that kind of, it's about the credibility that we feel in ourselves. It has nothing to do with the actual ability. It's about how do we feel about that. So, you know, I had two master's degrees, a global consultant for EY Financial Services, and my backside still couldn't start my own business because I was scared. So, you know, if that's me, and I realize that looking, I do that in retrospect. I do that as in, yeah, okay, that's craziness. But if that's me, then, you know, most of the successful business women that I see don't have that background and they're still caming it. And all of us together, you know, just like the leaders, they're leaders in their fields, they've all had to go through that. It wasn't necessarily confidence that pushed them into starting their own business. It was like a life circumstance or a passion. So it was just like, I cannot live by not doing this any longer. It was, I cannot live at the, you know, just kind of doing this job where I know that there is something inside of me, or I need to take care of my children in a different way. So I need to change. Like there was something else. It wasn't the, I'm confident enough to start my business today. Like it's never like that. It's always something. I have to care for my mom. She's ill. And so I'm going to start my internet business. And so,
yeah, it's
it's never
a need.
Exactly. Yeah. And you're right. There is something about the confidence, you know, in terms of when we do the leadership and management training, even at the MBA schools, the women and the men, the men don't, it's striking, actually. We owe it to them. I owe them a job. I owe them a job at IBM. I owe them as the professor, you know, my time, where women, I literally have to just like reach out and try to like, squeeze it out of them. Like, come visit me. Come to my office. We want me to introduce you to people. Like, and it's so even at that level, at an MBA level, they're just, you know, some of the best schools in the world.
Yeah. Well, and you will have been shot at some point in your career or in your life. You'll have probably been shot down for being told you were too bossy.
Oh, yeah.
And because you've been assertive in the past, and because you're concerned that that's going to happen to you again.
Exactly.
But I would also say that I don't go to bed every night or wake up every morning thinking, oh, maybe I'll be found out today. It's that constant thing that you're concerned that you, oh, God, have I done it right? Or I can't be, there's something in there, and it doesn't matter how I worry me. I mean, my 25-year-old, who is now a digital native wandering the world running his own business, the level of confidence he has in himself to be able to do that is, to me, is just absolutely beyond belief. Mm. And it is completely that difference in that sense. Mm. So anything that I think where women can also, not just within the mentoring is crucial, going on programs, leadership programs or technical programs like financial things and learning how to specifically do things. But having some angels around you, having the people around you who are going to tell you and going to tell you constantly that you are doing okay, that you are doing well, and that you aren't going to be found out because there's nothing to find out, is absolutely crucial.
But you start small as well. Yeah. I always say, you know, just we do this to ourselves. I think all of us, whether it doesn't matter where we're coming from on this, you know, you look at Steve Jobs and you look at Steve Jobs from Apple, or you look at, you know, Jeff Bezos from Amazon. What we use kind of as our examples for entrepreneurship and starting a small business is actually quite ridiculous.
Yes,
we don't think of the person who invented the toilet roll holder. We don't think of those, but they are actually millionaires and successful in their own right. Yep. We just think of these big and then we look at those guys, but then we also don't look at the 99 times they failed before that. We also look, we don't look at the fact that Steve Jobs actually got fired from his own company that he started. Let's really think about that. Like, that would gut someone else. I don't know many people who would go back after that and have a success. I certainly am looking at myself and saying I probably wouldn't. My pride would probably kill me. I'd be curled up in a ball in my bed. And so there is something about the resilience that that you develop in starting small and just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So I always say to people, if you're working 9 to 5, then you start your business in the 5 to 9. And you know, it's one thing at a time. It's, you know, it's the name and it's the website and it's the, you know, your product and your actual business plan. Like, how are you going to make money? It's the market research. And you can literally break down starting a business in small 2-hour daily steps for 3 months. And then all of a sudden at the end of it, you're like, oh, okay, then I have a business now. We're including, you know, so, and also if we work with the collaborative ways that we, you know, tend to work, in regards to focus groups, in regards to, you know, just saying, I'm taking part of this piece of the pie and working with others so that we can all share a piece of the pie. Mm-hmm. There are Absolutely. Infinitely more manageable mm-hmm. ways for us to jump into mm-hmm. business rather than just looking at that,
yep.
you know, net-a-porter kind yep. of, you know, massive Absolutely. Business, and you don't even know the junk that they went through in the beginning. Yep. I'm trying not to swear. The junk that they went through in the beginning just to get there, you know?
Yep.
So I think there's a level of authenticity that successful entrepreneurs need to have with us in terms of the amount of times that they failed or screwed up mm-hmm. and had to get back up again. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's also a level of just, okay, let's just kind of start small and reflect the whole 20-year journey towards that success rather than just like the year of success.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I want to talk about technology now. I mean, you did talk about that before around how it can play a role there in connecting people. You know, it's a great way for you to find people who are similar ilk or to promote yourself or to meet other angels, to do all sorts of positive, wonderful things that can help you with your business. But then there are also other elements of social media or being in that technology space. So can we just talk about that for how women in particular in that technology space, what does it mean? What does it look like? And I think, Melanie, you described it as an enabler. And I think, Kathy, you know, you're very, very busy in social. I think, you know, when you're in London, you're always tweeting. And so is it just, what does it mean for you, you know, as somebody who's also been in business for a long time? So, like, you know, when you first started
I've
business,
seen
there was no social. I don't know if there was computers.
There was no
anyway.
Computer. Sorry. No.
Yeah, that's
no,
right.
No, there was certainly a computer. Certainly I was one of the very old Amstrad.
Okay. Big one. A really big one.
It was that big. So, yes, so I have certainly computers were just, I first started in late 80s. So,
you've got the kind of
a pipeline point of view, yes, incredibly so. And from, but I can remember being here, the first few years we were in Australia, the very first contract we got in Hong Kong was because we were the only company that an economic development consultancy in Hong Kong could find a web page for with our particular services. They found one in the US and they found one in Australia. And that was the moment when we suddenly realized, something big here. Yes, we had a website. We had a website, but it was our very first website. But suddenly we had our first contract in Hong Kong and we've been working in Hong Kong for the last 15 years. The simple one click away.
Mm.
It's the one click away, and you know now that is what it is. But it was just the absolute eye opener that this certainly was going to be the way of the future for us, not just in terms of understanding distributed promotion and knowing who we were, but certainly from a changing the nature of our business and our understanding of what the impact of technology was having on the sector in which we were working in.
Mm.
So we had to be very much in at the front of all of that. So that would be
Do you have some advice for women in technology, like using technology today for their business?
I don't think I'm necessarily the best person to talk to on that. I think Matt's got some great advice.
All right.
With technology, it's really scary, you know. It's really scary in terms of, I love the internet so much. And that was my focus in financial services, internet banking. Used to be PC banking. And so I've grown up with it. And the success that I've had is because of the internet. It was accelerating of my career because of, you know, I manage this little team called PC Banking, and then all of a sudden I manage this huge team of, you know, 20 people and developers, and then it was making the bank huge amounts of cash. So I know I was accelerated throughout my career because I was comfortable and loved the internet when no one else even was really doing it. So I love it. I love it as an enabler. I love the flexible working that's come out of it. I love so many things in terms of the information and the research. The people that I speak to, the shared kind of the sharing of just inane situations and the sharing of, you know, wow and gender equality, and it's amazing. However, on the other hand, it's a poison chalice. It's a tool that can be used for such violence. You know, when I'm on the news on the BBC, I could be talking about I could be talking about pensions or Grexit or Brexit. And if I wear this big hair on TV, I will get trolled for the hair no matter what. It doesn't matter what I say. I could be saying the most lovely things about your parents or your children or your dogs and puppies. Like, we talk about puppies, and I will still get trolled for my hair. And the gendered-based violence, and it is so gendered. It's never about, oh, you're an idiot, you're stupid, you're ugly. Like, it's never neutral. Oh, no, it's about you need to get raped, or you're very, like, those are the nasty things that happen, you know, in terms of my, whether, it's never just about, it's those deep kind of identity attacks. And, you know, it doesn't matter if you're, you know, a women's athlete with a little bit of muscle, you know, it's so gendered, it's unbelievable. And it's so, and it encourages kind of this lack of accountability in terms of just dashing things out there and then not realizing the impact of your words. So on one hand, I love it because I see how many women have been empowered and linked across so many of our lives. And then on the other hand, the amount, it's just a reflection, I think, of, it's a reflection of the society in which we reside. So it's beautiful because women are getting empowered and it's empowering us, but then the underside is also being reflected out in the internet. So we wouldn't be here unless we had the internet. But then,
and I think the second down thing, I mean, which is nowhere near as bad as that, as what's happening from a trolling point of view, is you've got to learn to turn it off. And I think that is that's the hardest thing. Turn it off. There is a switch. Yeah. You can turn it off, and I think that's a very hard thing if you're running your own business, in whatever shape or form, to think that there are moments when you have to stop. If you are running your business through the same device that you are running the rest of your life, how do we do that? And I have tried it. I have tried split devices. I've tried split addresses, split accounts on absolutely everything.
Split personality.
And the problem, that's the problem. You just get constantly, you don't know whether you're coming or going. So how any of us manage the fact that that is intruding into our lives the whole time, I think that is the other really massive downside when you are, in particular when you're trying to run your own business, feel that you have to be on call the whole time for everybody, and men fix every problem, and et cetera.
It's lovely though, you know. It's lovely when you, particularly if you're speaking about women who, you know, we live. This is a big city, and Toronto's a big city, London's a big city. But then when I, you know, kind of make the time to go out to rural communities in India, and you know, they know my face, and it actually makes you tear up because that's all they can have access to on a daily basis. Like women in Nepal and Kathmandu, and I was like, wow, you know, you're on the side of the Himalayas, the Annapurna Range, and this woman is just like, hey. I saw you on BBC News and you were talking about Wow Kathmandu, and then you just think, wow, really, wow, it is amazing in terms of the access that it gives women, and it meets people. And then my business, I don't think I could have started it without the internet. And I'm not talking about the technical of it, I'm talking about the learning, the privacy of my house learning that, you know, in terms of, okay, you know, looking at other people who start businesses and, well, how do I start a business and company's house and, you know, like, how do I register with the government and trade names? Like, there's a lot of secret research that I can do. Sometimes, you know, you do use it on ex-boyfriends and stuff, but then actually, you know, you can really start it in a way that's not so, I have to walk into the small business building, or, you know, you can do it on your own time and figure it out. And so I do love that aspect as well, but it's a huge resource for us. And I if you're not ready to do it yet or start a business yet, then there are online courses as well.
I would definitely absolutely networking. Yeah, once you've done which I've done, I mean, had somebody talk to you, and somebody much, much younger than you talk to you about what sort of social media you should be using depending on the nature of your business and what you're doing, it is absolutely crucial, because you could spend your time, energy, and using all sorts of things because some friend has told you this and this new one's just come out and blah, blah, blah. And half of it's going to be a waste of time. And I think actually having an analysis done, a digital analysis done on what it is actually going to work for you depending on the nature of your business is crucial.
Yeah, and your target market, because quite frankly, my target market, you know, it, because it's about visibility, I have to use all of the channels, but I have a social media person.
Yeah.
And she, yeah. Well, because, again, women are trying to work. So she started up this whole thing, my social media PA.
Yep.
And she is so shy. I cannot describe to you how shy this young woman is. If I call her, she will not speak. If I email her, on the other hand, she has heaps to say. She is so quiet. She's so quiet, that means she listens really well, of course. That's what happens when you don't talk as much. And she, she's really good at listening to people and then hearing my voice. And so when you see comments that I make online on any of my social media profiles, it's usually not me. I hand the camera off to someone else, I take pictures of me, and I literally forward them straight to her. And she literally says it in my voice because I don't want to have that capability. Just like accounting, for example, I don't have it. Here's an accountant that I really trust, and he just makes sure, and I make sure I know it, because I'm not going to be Rihanna with people stealing my money. I have to sing songs about it, but it's, you know, but it's just, it is about kind of knowing, acknowledging that it's really, really important, and then deciding whether or not you outsource it.
Yeah.
Just like law, for example, just with any business, really, you can lawyers, accountants, social media, marketing, branding. There are some things that you can take in-house.
Yeah.
Technology, or there's some things that you're like, you know what, I'm never going to do this, I'm never going to find pleasure in it, and then I might as well go focus on making more money so I can actually pay for somebody to do it instead. So it's a nice,
That's a good point, isn't it? I mean, you've got to acknowledge that you can't do everything, but I suppose you do have to have that sort of, business structure behind being able to do that, you know?
Not really.
No,
definitely. It's about, I look at, with women, just consider yourselves as, you know, how much do you make an hour? Let's pretend you make $20 an hour, right? So just try to figure out, after tax, how much you make an hour. So if I say $20, for example's sake, and you know that having a maid to clean, or a cleaning person to clean your house, is $10 an hour. So if you're going to pay a cleaning service for $10 an hour, and you can get back 3 hours, and you can make £20 or $20 an hour, then what does that mean, really? You're making a profit.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is the discipline. That now you have to say, okay, instead of me spending, you know, 3 hours on cleaning, I'm going to spend three hours on developing my business and making money. So it's not necessary. You can apply it to, like, businesses, or you can apply it to small businesses.
Yeah.
By the time you get my backside around my figure, like accounting, or get my figures, or like figuring out the law and opening it, you know, the things, or figuring out social media and figuring out how to use Snapchat properly and filters, I could probably have paid for someone to do it really quickly, and then I just focus on making a lot more money. And so, it, you know, it's like...
But you don't have to employ them. That's
It's all about...
The structure. You outsource everything.
And you can outsource, like, little jobs as well, because remember, there are women on the other side who are saying, okay, wait a minute. All I want to do is be a copywriter, you know, a copywriter, and I only want to do it for a few hours a week because I have other commitments that I'm focusing on. And so there's this thing called Top Task, where I can hire students to do things for, you know, 1 hour or 2 hours. It can be researching. There's Fiverr and Elance and Olance and Odesk, where you can literally outsource some of these things quite quickly.
Mm.
I wouldn't say do with your accounting. I'm not going to lie. You know, whatever. Hold the money close to your chest and understand it a bit more. But everything else, you can do it as a sole trader, or not even a sole trader, just like a woman on the move. Or you could do it as a big business as well.
Yeah, and you're helping other people in business.
That's
really good.
Right. Yeah.
Yep. Well, I might actually open it out to the floor here, who you might want to ask some questions. So... here's your opportunity. I don't know if anybody has any questions for Melanie or Kathy.
Hi, my name's Liz Halp, so I work in the Office of Commonwealth Gains, and I'm working on a program to support businesses to maximise the opportunities that the Games provide, because, you know, we've heard about those equal events for women, and that's driving for gender equality. There'll be 100,000 visitors on the Gold Coast next year for the Games, so there's great opportunities, particularly for small businesses in those locations, but what sort of help might they need to take advantage of those opportunities and to make sure they don't, you know, sort of bankrupt themselves in preparing for it when, you know, the games are for a short time, but how can we sustain that growth?
I'm going to let Kathy end because she's actually here, so I know that she's already started to be involved with those conversations. Just generally, market information, and I would say kind of the target market information, you can get that from historically. So who descends on any given city, when and what services do they need when they get here? And what's the kind of their demographic? Because you just want to, it's great, you know, it's great that you're going to have all these people descend, but they're not going to really buy lawnmowers, are they? Like, you know, so the lawnmower guy probably not going to have to be that prepared. We never know because he might have to do all the lawn. So I guess what I'm saying is, you know, you can look historically, and that's what we did with the Olympics in London, to say what happens to a city every single time. So go to the people who have already gone through it.
So it might be better for you to close up shop for the 2 weeks.
Exactly, right? And then kind of board up their place so they know what kind of things. But so, yes, as a service, I would say that you'd want to provide that and then be able to help them match where they kind of fit in that spectrum. So start with the target market and start with how much people are used to paying and then how much the uplift can be. So again, it's a marriage between the service they offer and the services that will be required at the time of the year. I think I would start with that first, because that your whole business offering relies on that. They start from there, and then they say, okay, what do I need? If I have ice cream, if I'm selling ice cream, then my backside will be very busy, so how am I going to make that happen?
So do your research. Use the internet.
Do your research, but I think in terms of...
that's what you could
I think
be doing
as the infrastructure of any given city, you might want to get involved with that.
And it probably comes back to... we didn't get a chance to talk about it, but that really important part of having your own business, about being prepared and the business planning. So that scoping and, you know, looking out there and seeing what opportunities are there and what's right for you is really important. It's, you know, you don't just dive into something
because
you think it's
internet.
A great idea. You know, like
your SEO.
And that's what I meant. I mean, I wasn't being silly about it. Might be better for people not to be around.
Take a business
because
approach.
I think you really do have to take a complete business approach. And it's a bit like, you know, how I see a lot of non-profit organisations jumping at grants that happen to come across just because of the fact that they're there. Well, actually, that takes you off mission. And you don't want to be taken off mission. And business, even though they might be constructed differently, a business still should have a business plan and a mission in which they're going. And it would be silly to do that. But unless you've got the background knowledge and information, it's going to be very hard. And for small businesses, it's even harder. So I think that is great if government could do something like that. But the other thing I would also say is, I don't know what you're doing. We've heard this fantastic story this morning about a really great procurement story that of an First Nations business that has picked up one of the tenders in relation to delivery of services for the games, and it's what you're doing within that that will enable small businesses to actually get into that, because certainly my engagement as a small business with government, not in relation to my other side with my arts hat on, but my engagement with as a small business to government is just non-existent, because everything that comes out is not for me. I'm not structured in the way to deal with a lot of the tenders and the way in which they're structured and the scale that what's needed and the fact that the jargon and they're only created for a large scale business, and small scale businesses are never going to have that opportunity to get in there. I mean, that really needs to be unpicked to allow people to have the opportunity to pick up any work, employment or services as a small business for the games, and I'm sure you've already been thinking a lot about that.
Yeah, we have. You're right. While there are opportunities within procurement for small businesses, the opportunity is probably going to be outside that supply chain. And so, what information do they need? And more importantly, how can we help small businesses interpret that information so that it helps their business? And that's certainly the intention of our program. So, working with colleagues in Office of Small Business to try and we can provide some of the information, but hopefully they can provide support.
Yeah, it's really important to look at the other cities as well. And just like the Olympic, you know, with the Olympics for London, there were so many meetings with the other cities that had gone before to say, how are we going to have to change the infrastructure? And, you know, in Joburg as well, I remember being in Joburg right before the Games, and I thought, boy, how are we going to deal with that infrastructure transport situation? Because I'm not really seeing all these people. And it was transformed by the time I had gone back. It is, what you need to create a business in regards to saying what the target market is and who the demographics are, I think it'd be very helpful. But then also, you know, there are some organizations and some festivals that kind of descend on the town, and they have a list of suppliers, you know, like just literally a mapped list of in any given area. So for the WOW Festival, I think in Melbourne, you know, within a 5 kilometer radius, these were all the places that you're able to eat, and these are all the places that you were able to sleep. And it does take a lot of time to curate that, because you want to kind of verify that they are proper businesses. But again, it is about knowing what is about to happen to the city. And you know, with the Commonwealth Games, you pretty much know, because it's been happening. It's not like this is something new. This is not a new invention. And then it's also teaching the small businesses how to be found as well. So, you know, kind of the, not just a small mom and pop kind of thing, but, you know, there are going to be a bunch of people who are going to Google Commonwealth Games Gold Coast Hotel, Commonwealth Games Gold Coast Restaurant, best places to eat,
so
those kinds of things.
I would actually say immediately, are you actually going to do something so that women coming might actually, or anybody else coming, might actually be interested in buying something for a business owned by a woman. So are you working with femme economy? I mean, where are you thinking about that could well be? Is there, if we've got WOW, we've got an equality agenda for the games, we've got all this other stuff going on, what about some sort of app that's actually allowing anybody who comes to Queensland at the time to actually be able to see, but to buy responsibly in a gender equality sense? I mean, the fact that Sheba's just launched is fantastic, and I don't know how Sheba's going to, but that is, for me, everybody knows what Sheba is.
Sheba
is Uber for women. So it's a couple of, it's a woman in Melbourne who's actually created Sheba. There's another one as well. ABC did a big feature of them last week. So Sheba, to me, when I heard that, I thought, but of course they're going to do it here. So they launched in Melbourne and Brisbane, I think, at the same time. Because when we were doing our research for WOW originally on the Gold Coast, one of the big things that we discovered is the violence towards women on the Gold Coast at a time of a major event is astronomical. That's why some of the figures that come out of the Gold Coast in relation to sexual violence are high, because it's an event city. So there is a lot of work being done on that. And so from a business point of view, Sheba, women only drivers, and it's been set up by women who were concerned about their daughters being out late at night and how to get them home, which, you know, a lot of people have been through. Wow, God, that's going to be an opportunity on the Gold Coast. Fantastic. So what can you do in relation to your own procurement policies to potentially do something like that? Or if you can't do it, how can WOW help? Because we're not caught necessarily in your... How can you partner with somebody? Because you might not be able to do it through government because of your own procurement policies.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know.
But it does, I guess, it's all about looking at those opportunities. I think I was reading something in one of the media clips yesterday around she power and travel, you know, like how women going away for weekends with their girlfriends and stuff is driving a real travel boom in some parts of Queensland, and they're going to places where they feel safe and where they can have fun, you know. So I guess it's about, you know, I guess it's sort of having that sort of targeted approach and maybe thinking about how we can, you know, leverage our partnerships and look around and see what else is happening. So there's unfortunately, a bit of work to do. I don't want to give Lynn any more work. Any more questions from anybody?
I was just going to say, with following on what you just said about a procurement list of women in business for around the games, we're already doing that for the... there's an element of what we're doing that with the Indigenous suppliers and making sure that we... procure Indigenous supplies as well. So maybe that's something that we, as the Office of Commonwealth Games, could incorporate as well. You've got the women suppliers and the Indigenous suppliers as well. So people can choose
That's right.
Yeah.
I mean, but
or they could do both.
And we're all guilty of it. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing it. Of not putting a gender lens on things. Mm-hmm. So I mean, I think that's what I would say. Go back and look at everything you're doing, and then place a gender lens across it, and think, oh, maybe we need to think about that differently in that in mm-hmm. that context.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's tough.
Yeah.
Mm, very tough.
Yeah, so and when we put the gendered lens in, then the black woman is just forgotten.
Yes.
So it's putting lenses, I guess, in terms of underrepresented communities, wherever you are.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I did have one other question.
Sure.
And I don't mind who answers it. I believe that our actions or people's actions are directly correlated to the way in which they view the importance or the value of what they do. And for women in business or even women in our jobs, what advice do you have for us to keep an empowering context for ourselves and the work that we do when we do come up against criticism or whatever roadblocks we come up against? What advice can you offer for us to keep an empowering context about what we do?
I think I need a squad, my friends, I need those friends, and there's an element of self-care in the friends that I have. When there's a trauma, so when someone says something really horrible, or I remember when I first got trolled on online, I ran to my friends. I remember I was at a financial services firm, and I was being interviewed to be a client or to be a consultant for them, and then they're like, oh, who do you know at this firm? And I was like, actually, I know your black network. I know the leads. And they're like, oh, are you just an angry black woman? And I was just like, oh, that's nice. Ha, of course not. Mm-hmm. Because that's what you have to do. It's a coping mechanism. There was no way I could be angry, even though, of course, you're making me angry. Like, it's really hard. You feel so disempowered, right? And, it's just the same thing. Like, when you're like, oh, wow, you're just a dumb blonde. Like, how else are you supposed to react? There's a trauma, so that you get the trauma. And then I ran to my girlfriends, thank God, who were able to put perspective around it. I would encourage any woman to acknowledge the micro indignities that we take in the kind of the social constructs and the economic constructs that we work in right now. So don't pass it off that I'll be fine. When someone says something to you or when something is done. Even if you don't say it out loud, just to acknowledge it inside, because it does go somewhere. It hurts. And then afterwards, when you have your friends that tell you, no, you're not crazy, that's racist. Or you're not crazy, that's sexist. Yeah. And you feel so much better for it. And that's why it's so important to have a network of people that you can... that's a network of people that you can run to and kind of find comfort in, and not always be strong and not always be like taking care of everyone else. But they'll help take care of you when you aren't doing it for yourself. Because usually we mama bear other people. If someone else got that, I'd be like, what did you say? And I'd just be like, mama bear. It says it to me, and then I run crying and scared, and I can't even defend myself. So,
and where you can call it out.
Yeah.
I just think that's the other thing. I think, and I know it's hard, and I certainly know it's hard in certain positions, in certain institutions, and how you do that. And I think networking internally within that institution, because that could, what's been said to you, or what whatever it is that's happened that's disempowered you that particular day, it could well have happened to the person down the corridor the day before, or the one in the other department 2 weeks before, or whatever. And if there are groups of women across, if that's the culture, if that's the sector that you're in, that's why those network, growing those groups and having the capacity to talk within those groups is absolutely crucial. And that's the problem, obviously, though, when it comes to small businesses and people who are actually working for themselves.
Yeah.
And I think that we do need better networks and better structures for women who are doing that. Does anybody know about the alternative board? Is anybody here from the alternative board? There, great, good. I just wanted to... Yeah, that's what I just wanted to... I wanted to...
What's that? I don't know what that is. Do you guys know what that is?
No. I don't have to say it. Say it.
We get business owners together in groups, usually between 5 to 10 business owners in a group, and we work together on the challenges and opportunities we face in our business together. So we share our successes, we share our failures, and we learn from each other and help each other be better in our businesses.
Yeah. Good.
Excellent.
See?
That's brilliant.
Okay. That's.
Is that okay? Does that answer your question?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Well, I think we're about done. Thank you. Joanne, are you going to give the thanks?
Oh, say thanks. Yeah, yeah, thank you very much. Thank you, Sandra, for facilitating today. And awesome. Kathy and Mel, thanks very much for sharing your time and expertise with us. Everybody, thank you for coming along. Please join me in thanking our speakers.